Thank you. Ephraim, I'm glad you mentioned the fact that Primakov began as a journalist. He's not the only person that we know of who started as a journalist and wants to be a prime minister. You know, as we were sitting, it's been a fascinating afternoon, and everybody's either an ambassador, a doctor, or a professor. I'm reminded that Henry Kissinger, who has been mentioned countless times here this afternoon, was once asked, you know, how do you want to be addressed, as Secretary Kissinger, Dr. Kissinger, Professor Kissinger? He said, Your Highness will do. One more point on a lighter note, I think Dan Ketzer will bear me out, is Hal Saunders was telling us about how the concept of shuttle was built up and staying in the region. I think when Secretary Christopher went for the first time to Damascus, President Hafez al-Assad asked him, what is the purpose of your visit? And Secretary Christopher said, well, we want to make peace between Syria and Israel. And Assad said, well, how long did you come for? And he said, well, we are leaving tomorrow. And Assad, with his wry sense of humor, said, in 1974, Henry Kissinger spent here a whole month making a disengagement agreement between Israel and Syria, and you want to come for one day and make peace between Israel and Syria. But this is only an illustration of how long-lasting the impact of this bedrock of the peace process, those first years. And I will treat 73 to 79 as one piece, has had over the peace process for four decades. Another example, the return to Camp David, the fact that Camp David was chosen at the site of the failed effort to make peace between Israel and the Palestinians in July 2000 was not accidental, because one of the motivations was let's come back to the place where the breakthrough happened once, and in so many other ways. So I'd like to take a look in those years from today's perspective, and look mostly at two issues. The peace process, the American-Israeli relationship and partnership in managing this peace process. The Arab-Israeli conflict is 65 years old. The full-fledged Arab-Israeli conflict began in 1948. Of course, we can go back to the late 19th century for the beginnings of the Arab-Jewish conflict in Palestine, but the full-fledged conflict involving the whole Arab world goes back to 1948. This is 65 years. Pretty amazing that we have 65 years of conflict and 40 years of a peace process trying to resolve it. An unusual proportion, which bears witness to the complexity and depth of this conflict. When the first Arab-Israeli war ended in 1949, it did not end with a peace agreement. The armistice agreements were signed. It was stated that this was just a prelude to peace agreements that would follow. They did not follow. The conflict festered and culminated in two more wars in 1956 and 1967. 1967 actually created the basis for an Arab-Israeli peace process. One of the reasons that the 1948 war did not end in a peace settlement, and that all subsequent efforts at the end of the war, in immediate aftermath and subsequent years to resolve the conflict failed, was that there were no assets to trade off. What the Arabs wanted in terms of concrete assets and in terms of redressing their humiliation and what is known in the Arabic jargon as the injustice of 1948 is against Israel's sense of insecurity and the insistence on minimum conditions could not be reconciled if Arabs wanted the return of their refugees or a corridor linking Egypt to Jordan. This was not acceptable to Israel, and there were no assets that Israel could offer back. They were created by the outcome of the 1967 war. And as has been mentioned before, the government of Israel, in the immediate aftermath, on June 19, 1967, did decide that it was willing to return the Sinai and the Golan for peace, in return for peace agreements, that is to say, territories for peace. The concept, in a way, was born then, and already also marked the Palestinian issue, the future of the West Bank, as a separate issue. But between 1967 and 1973, these assets could not be used, and the blame lies partly with the Arabs and partly with us. I will not get into the question of who carries what blame, but between the resolutions of Khartoum and the sense of cockiness and complacency that Israel had, the ground was not ripe for settlement. American-Israeli relationship during these years matured. Let me just remind us all of how fresh it all was. It was a fairly cool relationship in the 50s, slight change in 58, not such an easy relationship in the Kennedy years. Only after 1967, in the Johnson-Eshkol years, a close relationship was built that led to the close, intimate relationship that we are all familiar with. Close, intimate, but full with tensions, and some of what Ephraim just mentioned to us, how what seemed one day to be a very close, intimate relationship, let's say in the intelligence area, could be put at risk and almost obliterated on the next day on a whim or for another reason. There were two streaks in the American view of that relationship that, again, were mentioned. I'd like to dwell on it for a couple of minutes. Let's call it the White House view, primarily framed by Kissinger, that looked at it through a Cold War American-Soviet rivalry framework, and the State Department view. And the Rogers Plan of 1969 is a very revealing way of looking at it. For the State Department, Secretary Rogers, terrified to some extent by Gaddafi's takeover in Libya, in a sense that U.S. support for Israel could undermine all of America's conservative friends in the region, it was important to try to bring this to an end and settle on less than full peace for the return of the territories. For Kissinger, this was a calamity. There was, of course, the personal rivalry with Rogers, the institutional rivalry between White House and State Department, and the President's own dismissive view of the State Department, I think, was demonstrated to us in Bill Kwan's presentation, what he showed us on the screen. Kissinger's argument was very powerful. He said, if you lean on Israel in 1969 and force Israel to withdraw from the Sinai and the Golan and give them back to Egypt and Syria, the beneficiary would be the Soviet Union, their patron. And I'm not against Israel giving back the Sinai and the Golan, but the United States should be the beneficiary. So when a situation develops where the United States orchestrates this process and reaps the benefits of this, then, of course, it would be a different matter. This is something that began to take shape before the war in 1972 when Egypt expelled the Soviet experts and the winds of change were in the air, as again we heard several times in the course of the afternoon, and matured fully during and in the aftermath of the October War. And what happened as a result of that was that the American-Israeli partnership in the Middle East shifted to a different basis. If between 67 and 73 the partnership was based on common enmity with the Soviet Union and with the radical Arab regimes, after 1973 it was based on the following. The United States could be the friend of Israel, the ally of Israel, but it could also be, because of the special relationship with Israel, the power that provides the Arabs the territories they want back. And the tension between being the friend of Israel and having a good relationship with Arabs could be reconciled by the United States overseeing, orchestrating a peace process. In a way, this is what unfolded between 1973 and 1979. As the United States managed the peace process and built the relationship with Egypt and completed Egypt's transition from the Soviet camp to the American orbit, one of the greatest diplomatic triumphs of the Cold War period. Let me mention, there was a brief moment in which it seemed that Israelis and Egyptians could go it alone. The Yariv Gamasi meetings in Kilometer 101 were frowned upon to some extent by Kissinger, who obviously wanted to manage the process for the reasons that I mentioned. But I'm singling it out because it's a motif that repeats itself in the peace process in the following decades. Oftentimes you can hear Israelis say, oh, when we deal with Arabs alone, we do it better. Oslo, other examples. Why do we need mediators or orchestrators? But at the end of the day, no single Arab-Israeli agreement was completed and implemented without American participation. And the question of the dosage is very important. What dose do you need? At what point the United States needs to get into the picture? Not too early, because then it becomes a mediator with its own interest vested in or invested in the process, but at some point it needs to come in to help complete it and to underwrite it. But so that the tension between wanting to go it alone and the recognition that it cannot be done and sustained without the United States began then and remains with us in the peace process. Now I'm using the word peace process, and again I want to go back to Hal Saunders, who said, in the first few years we didn't call it the peace process, we called it the engagement process. The Israelis used another term. We called it what we call in Hebrew, say first Tahalich Hesder, because Hesder is settlement, it's not a full-fledged peace. But of course, if you translate it from the neutral Hebrew term to English, settlement, and you talk to Arabs about settlements, they don't like it very much. But this was the somewhat awkward term that we used between 73 and 77 to indicate that we were moving ahead, but not quite in what was a peace process. Actually, if you dig further, the word peace was first introduced in 1971 by Sadat in his letter to Yaring. So the peace actually was planted there, but it's true. The real quest for, or the quest for full-fledged peace, it doesn't begin before 77. So from that point on, it really is a peace process. Now, the peace process actually had three layers from the first days. Dealing with the consequences of 73, dealing with the consequences of 67, and dealing with 1948. All three layers were there all along. Now, it was very wise or clever of Kissinger to to focus, obviously, initially on dealing with the consequences of 1973. They were muddled enough, and everybody needed to be done with the war and move on, try to normalize life on both sides. And this provided fuel for the process. Did very well in the 6-point agreement, the first initial agreement, the 2 disengagement agreement, the interim agreement, and then it began to run out of steam. And here I'm coming back to Hal Saunders, not just because you are here, but because you were there. In November 1975, Chairman Hamilton, who was chairman of a subcommittee in the Congress, held hearings for the first time on the Palestinian question. And Hal Saunders testified on behalf of the administration, and he testified and he laid a paper on the commission's desk, and the paper contained a very interesting phrase. It said that the Palestinian problem is the core of the issue. The Palestinian issue is the core of the problem, I'm sorry. The Palestinian issue is the core of the problem. Now, of course, this is a pregnant sentence, because if it is the core of the problem cannot be dealt with if you don't deal with the core. So there is a policy a conclusion inherent in that formulation. Now I checked with Hal yesterday, and he verified to me that the secretary Kissinger did go over the text. This was not a personal statement by Hal Saunders, but this was the administration's administration position as cleared by the Secretary of State, which meant that it was beginning to gel, or the sense was beginning to gel, that you cannot just deal with 73 and 67. You really, if you want a peace process, you have to deal with the core issues of the conflict, and of course the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is at the core of that conflict. Okay, now so we dealt with 1973 in the agreements that were signed between in 73-74. The interim agreement between Israel and Egypt was beginning to deal with 1967, because it involved further withdrawal in the Sinai. The,
Thank
you. It dealt with 1967. I said, but as earlier than that, in 1974, there was an effort to deal with the Palestinian problem, or to outskirt the Palestinian problem by trying to push the idea of an Israeli-Jordanian agreement, the Jericho Plan, that Rabin decided finally that he did not have the political muscle to accomplish, and decided to do without it, and was shoved aside. But there was an attempt to deal with the Palestinian issue by actually outskirting it and bringing Jordan back into the picture as the repository of the Palestinian issue. That was tried briefly in 1974, was not followed. 1975, the beginning of a sense of change, and then the transition from the Ford-Nixon, call it administration, to the Carter administration, and here we have the Brookings report, a very important, very interesting document. I'm standing here on the podium in a think tank. No think tank could think of a greater moment when a paper prepared in the think tank by a group becomes the blueprint of a policy of a government or an administration. But this is what happened with the Brookings report that recommended abandoning the phased diplomacy of Kissinger, the step-by-step approach, trying to accomplish a comprehensive settlement of the Arab-Israeli conflict, including a resolution of the Palestinian problem by establishing a Palestinian state, and the need to deal with the Soviet Union, with Syria, and with the Palestinians. And some of the authors of that report went into the Carter administration, and it was adopted by President Carter actually as the blueprint for his policy, and led to the head-on collision with Prime Minister Rabin in March 1977, the visit he had with President Carter at the time, and eventually, after the Soviet-American joint communique of October 1, helped push Sadat and Begin into each other's arms, and dialectically, this quest for a comprehensive settlement led to a bilateral agreement between Israel and Egypt, led to the first Arab-Israeli peace treaty. Again, mostly in 1967, but an effort to deal, or the necessity to deal also with the Palestinian issue. Of course, Begin was hoping that by giving Sadat the whole of the Sinai, he would get both a peace relationship with Egypt and an Egyptian willingness to turn a blind eye to the Palestinian issue. Sadat originally was willing to settle on a formula. He wanted a verbal formula dealing with the Palestinian issue. Begin, a legal or legalistic mind, did not want the formula because he was afraid of the far-reaching consequences, and he came up with the idea of an autonomy taken from his universe in Central and Eastern Europe in the 20s and 30s that, as we know, went nowhere. So this phase ended in 1979, and we then had various phases of movement forward and then setbacks in a peace process over the past 40 years. In the 90s, actually, it was reversed when the Rabin government ended up signing the Oslo Agreement with the PLO rather than making a deal with Syria. We suddenly came back to Hal Saunders' point. Now that we recognized Palestinian nationalism, Palestinian nationalism recognized us, we were dealing with the core of the problem, and we wanted everybody else to move on with us. We then discovered it was somewhat more complex. For instance, Egypt was very unhappy with the failure to implement the Palestinian component of the Camp David Accords and the peace treaty with Egypt, was not that all that happy. Amr Moussa particularly and the neo-Nasserites were not all that happy that Israel was suddenly becoming a regional power and an actor, and became somewhat of a spoiler in the peace process in coming years. So we need to ask ourselves, why is it that we've had 40 years of a peace process not culminating in a settlement? So we never freed ourselves, so we never managed to set free from the original problem makeup of the conflict, the disparity in numbers, the sense among many Arabs that time is on their side. I mean, look at the numbers, and at some point numbers will talk. Some developments were added on to the original makeup of the conflict. The role of religion that today is much more prominent than it was on both sides 20 or 30 years ago. The fact that the Middle East changed, and not necessarily for the good, that the Middle East that we have today is not the Middle East of 30 or 40 years ago. Iran is a major player. Turkey is back in the Middle East. It's a different Middle East. But we are still with that original distinction. 1973, 1967, 1948. We are at this point an Israeli-Syrian negotiation on 1967 between Syria and Israel is not realistic. It will be a while before Syria is in any shape to think about or negotiate with Israel, and we don't even know what shape the Syrian state will have in a year, two, or three. But we are in the mid or in the beginning of another round of an effort to start an Israeli-Palestinian negotiation, that is to say, back dealing with 1948. That remains a very important reality. And a final point, since we have spoken so much about the Soviet Union, the American-Soviet competition, the question of who manages the Middle East or possibly in the Middle East, and tying it to yesterday's development, the idea of trying to resolve the current impasse in Syria by Russia taking charge of the Syrian chemical weapons. Will the Syrian crisis, which became the defining issue, strangely enough, in to some extent American domestic politics, international politics, and so forth, would that conflict be resolved by Russia playing the major role in resolving it? This would be an interesting turn of the wheel. Thank you.